The following program contains adult themes, coarse language, and images that may offend some viewers.
They like to say theirs is the hardest game. Their players, the toughest.
We attract an aggressive, young, risk-taking male. Long as I remember,
it was me and you. The NRL spent almost $1 million this year on an ad campaign to attract more young risk-takers to the code.
We're in the business of attracting people to our game, and the younger we can get them, the better.
Since he was young, he thought he'd go far. 48 hours after its release, the star of the campaign, Brett Stewart, was embroiled in scandal. Drunk at the Manly season launch, facing charges of sexual indecency.
Are you going to fight the charges?
They, at a golden triangle of celebrity status, a lot of money and too much time.
Rugby league has always attracted camp followers. But today's young players have moved with the times, sexting and circulating pornographic videos on mobile phones.
This is all the time. This young girl was, you know, having sex with one of the players, and they had their cameras in there, their phones in there, and other players were videoing it going on their cameras.
It was the Canterbury Bulldog scandal in 2004 that uncovered the depraved practice of group sex with vulnerable young women. NRL officials expressed shock, but they should have seen it coming. 2 years earlier, the details of another horrifying incident were kept from the public.
There was always hands on me, and there was always, if one person had stopped, someone was touching me and doing something else. There was never a point where I was not being handled.
Best thing about a 2009 NRL...
After we approached him last week, the other face of the NRL's recruitment drive, Matthew Johns, made a preemptive apology on national television.
For me personally, put my family through enormous anguish and embarrassment, and has once again, and for that I'm just... Well, can't say sorry enough.
Johns wasn't alone. At least 11 other players and staff were in the room, and many more have kept this degrading secret.
To a lot of people.
All right, mate. Well said. All right, let's get on with the show.
I had my eyes shut, a lot of it, and when I opened my eyes, there's just a long line at the end of the bed.
Tonight on Four Corners, women break rugby league's code of silence. Game day at Newcastle Stadium. A big day for the local fans. This is the first home game of the season for the Newcastle Knights. In the dressing room, the players are in the final stages of preparation before kickoff.
These guys are pumped up. They are playing a very aggressive game, and they are putting their bodies on the line. It's fearless. It's not as bad as going to war, and I wouldn't suggest that, but it's probably like the old gladiator days, and they get out there and they belt the hell out of each other, and there's probably no other game that is like it.
Their opponents today are the Manly Sea Eagles. Last year's champions, Manly haven't won a game since their alcohol-fueled season launch.
Yeah, I think it's really affected Manly. They're not playing very good football at the moment.
When you get men and alcohol mixed together, you're going to get idiots. So it's that's
turn
just
into idiots.
Yes, they do.
Hamstrings, groins.
Newcastle plans to capitalise on the disarray at Manly. One of Manly's key players, Anthony Watmo, punched a sponsor at the season launch. The Knights are preparing to single him out on the field. Manly's star player, Brett Stewart, is still on suspension for being drunk at the same event.
Get the shot.
Brett Stewart getting suspended was, I thought, ridiculous.
Devastated and demoralised by their start to the season, last year's champions are on the ropes.
Not since Brisbane in 99 and Melbourne in 2000 have the Premiers lost the opening four matches at the start of the new season. On the home side, it's their first game of the year on their home ground.
The relentless violence of the game creates an obvious problem. How do you create gladiators who don't take risks off the field?
And it's taken by Kurt Gidley.
You've got Kurt Gidley, who's 87, 88 kilos, and he gets hit by three guys sometimes who are in excess of 100 kilos going the other direction, all trying to hurt him, not just stop him, but hurt him. That's the nature of the game. Now, anyone who does that for a job is a risk taker, willingly loves a risk and challenges himself on risks.
Ball comes out, went backwards to Houston.
When we want them on the field, we want them to be aggressive. They've got to make tackles, they've got to be fearless. Then we want them to do things that other people don't do. So we attract an aggressive, young, risk-taking male. We give them a shower, put a suit on them, and then say, now we want you to be, you know, a submissive male. We want you to go out there and not have any problems. It's very difficult to do that.
Second half is always the hardest. Let's see what you're made of.
In the dressing room at half-time, the Knights are leading 10-6. But there's no let-up from coach Brian Smith.
Or do you just soft-cock it and find another fucking reason? You're too young, we're not experienced, we're still a fucking team getting together. I'm afraid it's all over, boys. I'm afraid no one's going to buy that, not even me anymore.
Having incited his young charges to put everything on the line for victory, Smith goes out to watch them thrash the Premiers.
So the Knights have terrorised Manly on the fringe and out wide. Draws a fullback and Kurt Gidley, one of the best support players in the game.
Exhausted by a physical contest as hard as any in sport, Newcastle's young warriors are ready to taste the spoils of victory. Managing their emotions on the field is one thing. As history proves, managing what happens off the field is much harder.
We need to split that thing where you're a risk taker here, son, brother, whatever, and we admire and laud you for all of that risk taking, and you're so good at it. But hold on a minute. When you come off there, can you just not take any risks? Don't be like the rest of the male under 25, 30 population. Don't go out there and get on the drink and take risks. And that's hard.
Just how hard it is to manage young players became obvious for last year's champions on the day they launched their 2009 season. At the centre of Manly's off-field drama, their two key players, Brett Stewart and Anthony Watmo. Sarah Durazza went to the launch with her father, one of the club's sponsors.
It was actually a lot of fun. Like, you know, I was sitting talking with Brett Stewart and Matt Orford, he's an awesome captain. We were having a lot of fun. We're actually talking about me when I used to do pageants and how I won Miss Freshwater and stuff. He
was fine. Durazza is a charity ambassador and not a regular follower of football.
Was there a lot of alcohol?
There was a lot of alcohol, definitely.
He's revelling in his Man of the Match award. Let's give him a welcome. Anthony Truck Watmo.
Anthony Watmo was supposed to be one of the stars of the event. Recent hero of the World Club Championship and a member of the Australian Rugby League team. Watmo got progressively drunk through the afternoon.
Well, he was slurring his words, he couldn't stand straight. It was pretty obvious that he was intoxicated. Like, you know, had the unbuttoned shirts and, like, you know, didn't look very presentable at all. And I don't think he was very happy that the fact that I didn't know he was a footballer as well, because he had intruded into a conversation with me, Brett Stewart and Matt Orford.
So what sort of language did he use?
The language that was used was like, you know, F this, F that. So going up to my father going, you should be disgusted in your daughter. And you know, just putting me completely down, saying that I'm a piece of shit. And he did say to my dad, how can you let your daughter walk out of the house in a dress like that? And yes, the dress was above the knee, but I don't have to justify myself to anybody.
You set the bar very high for 2009. Congratulations on your even around the old orchestra.
Did you find that he was aggressive towards you?
Yes, definitely. I was quite scared. I was very much in shock after the whole incident and during the incident as well.
It ended in an altercation between Watmo and Daraja's father outside on the balcony.
There was just a bit of violence that happened. You know, my dad was hit in the face.
How was he hit?
It was only very slightly, like, in the jaw, just under here, so...
And who was that?
Anthony Watmo had done that to my father.
He punched him?
Yeah. Ever since he was
young, he thought he'd go far. Brett Stewart presented the NRL with an even bigger problem. The face of rugby league for 2009 was drunk at the launch. Later that evening, he was involved in an incident with a 17-year-old girl outside his apartment building. Stewart now faces charges of indecent assault. He denies the allegations, which will be tried in court. Despite being drunk at the launch, both Stewart and Watmo were at the next training session, preparing to play in Manly's first match of the season.
Their whole persona, the whole reputation of the club, the whole ethos of the club is we don't care what you think, we know you hate us, and so here, stick this.
This morning we've met with representatives of the Manly Club.
It was left to the NRL to step in and penalise the club and suspend Stewart for being drunk.
We intend to impose a fine of $100,000 on the club. By their own admission, the drinking at that function, their season launch, was unacceptable.
Watmo was fined by Manly, but not made to apologise to Sarah Daraja. Is it acceptable that Anthony Watmo hasn't apologised to her yet?
No.
Do you think that he should?
Yes.
Do you think it's necessary for the NRL to take steps to ensure that happens?
No.
I didn't deserve to be spoken down to and treated like I was a nobody and a piece of crap. That's how I could pretty much put it. But with males talking over females and, you know, doing that in public, it's violence against women. It's verbal abuse.
Does the NRL have a problem with players' attitudes towards women?
I think they recognise that there may be an image that rugby league has in its attitude towards women, and I think some of that's quite founded over the years. I think it is being taken seriously by most clubs. I wouldn't say all clubs, but most clubs, and there lies the problem.
The Newcastle Knights have been embroiled in their own controversies in the past. Rugby league legend Andrew Johns still advises the players at his old club. Johns' public admission 2 years ago that he used ecstasy and other drugs while playing for Newcastle rocked the entire code.
That certainly woke us up that, you know, if it can happen to the best player in the world, well, certainly it can happen to other players.
2 years ago, Newcastle were a club in disarray. They were bottom of the table, losing faith with their fans and losing sponsors. The incoming CEO, Steve Burriston, decided the club had to change.
It was all about culture. It was about introducing a new culture. So we had to get rid of any chance that our players were going to fall into illicit substances. That's probably the biggest no-no that we had to address.
Coach Brian Smith was brought in to rebuild the team after the departure of Andrew Johns. He recognised that the club's problems started with alcohol and the drinking culture.
It was my job to sell the concept of changing the amount of alcohol that people were drinking, that sort of let your hair down is how, that's the only way we can really bond together. We're learning how to do that.
Smith knows that Newcastle's approach isn't supported by all the teams in the NRL.
There probably are still one or two coaches who are still living by the train hard, drink hard, play hard
motto. Who are they?
No, I'm not going there, baby.
Like most clubs, Newcastle had to learn the hard way. Some of the current players, including captain Kirk Gidley, lived through one of Newcastle's most controversial episodes. In February 2005, before the current coach and CEO arrived, Newcastle were playing a pre-season match against the Penrith Panthers in Bathurst. The game coincided with the first weekend of term for students at Charles Sturt University.
There were new students, there were old students, there were locals. Everyone was out because it's such a massive night in Bathurst. I mean, everyone was, it's fair to say, pretty annihilated, but having an awesome time.
Caroline, as we'll call her, had just moved into the university dorm.
My recollection is, leaning on my brother, him taking me up the stairs, and he said to me the next day that he'd actually made a point of not locking my door so that in case I needed to get out in the night, in case I need to be sick or go to the toilet or get a glass of water.
The Knights were staying in a hotel next door. 12 of the players broke curfew and went on a rampage around the dorm.
I remember it was an early sharp. We ended up having a few back at the hotel in a room. And I think it's actually down the road, might have been next door. I think there was actually a few uni students having a beer. So we thought it might be all right just to go down. And it was actually outdoors for a start. And this didn't seem to be too much harm in the time, but obviously there was a few things that weren't right.
One of the players peeled off from the group and walked into a girl's room.
As I'm lying there, face down, arms out on the bed, head on the pillow, he climbs on top of me and straddles me and sits sort of on my thighs. He started to rub my back. And like just using the word makes me feel sick, but he was caressing my back and saying in like this sort of soft voice, you know, roll over, roll over. You'll enjoy it, just roll over. Just roll over, he just kept saying it. Just roll over, just roll over. And then he started to put his hands around me between my body and the mattress, like in the front of me, my front, and doing the same things to the front of me that he was doing to my back. And he put his hands down to, I don't know, what do you say, touch my private parts.
So when that happened, what did you do then?
He obviously picked up then that I was really starting to get stressed because I was saying, you know, get off, who are you, get out, who are you, get off. And really started to try and sort of struggle, like get up on my elbows and try and get him off. And eventually he got off and walked out the door. And left the door open.
For a place where many students study communications, it was hard to get a word out of anybody today. But officially,
the story of the Newcastle players' drunken night got out the next day. The media quickly focused on rumours that rookie player Dane Tilse may have been involved in an assault on a student.
I went in to where my brother was and told him what happened.
What did your brother say? Did he think that you should go to the police?
My poor brother.
so bad for not locking that door. He felt so bad. He didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to do. I just wanted everyone just to shut up about it, really.
Caroline initially went to the police.
It is a criminal investigation. We have interviewed the alleged victim, and we are in the process of interviewing a number of witnesses.
Love their players.
But she decided not to press charges.
Take that on. There is no way. It's not like if he was just another guy, I would be going up against him. If I'm going up against Dane Tills, I'm going up against him, the football team, the NRL, their fans. I'm not going to take that on.
Hit with a $100,000 fine by the NRL, the club in turn then slapped fines totalling $50,000 on 12 players.
But Dane Tills told Four Corners he went into Caroline's room, but only tickled her back.
We are committed working hard towards rebuilding that trust. Thank you.
The club sacked him, and he was deregistered by the NRL for a year. Steve Burriston wasn't at Newcastle at the time, but he'd coached Tills in the past.
He was 17-year-old when I was coaching him, and I couldn't imagine him doing the wrong thing. I couldn't. That was a hell of a shock to me. I know he's gone to Canberra, I know he's playing good footy, and I know he's never had a problem since. So I think that you'll find in most of these cases that there's a common denominator, and that's alcohol.
Do you think it would happen like that now? The way the club is now, do you think something like that would happen?
No way, no. No, not even the last couple of years. We've got steps in place where if we go somewhere, we go as a group. There's no little groups that are breaking off going to a different direction. So there's a curfews in place. It's come a long way since then.
If some young footballers mistakenly think all women want to have sex with them, Charmaine Pallavi is one who doesn't necessarily discourage the idea. She's getting ready for a night on the town with her girlfriends, applying the finishing touches, bronzer to her legs.
You know, it's an early night for me.
What's the appeal of those boys, though?
The normie.
The footy boys. What's the appeal of the footy boys?
They just got really good bodies. And then they're a bit cheeky, they're naughty, and they're pretty confident. Mostly their bodies. They've got great bodies, so.
The Normanby is a Brisbane institution and a favourite haunt of league players.
The women that go there know that footy players go there. Throughout the night, like, they just get drunker and drunker, and you see the girls, you know, they'll disappear for a little while, a guy and a girl. And, you know, if you're anywhere near the toilets in Normanby, you'll see them go in there.
So what's going on in the toilets?
Sex.
Damien's here, so another drink, maybe, tell him. Isn't that chick?
Charmaine says she sleeps with footballers, but on her terms.
It's consensual, for a start. I'm not drunk or on drugs. And it's in, has some, an element of class to it, do you mean? It's either in the privacy of my own bedroom or in a hotel room or their house, not in a toilet or the back of a car or, you know, at some player's house on the lounge with everyone's watching and that.
She doesn't drink much. On one occasion 2 years ago when she did get drunk on her birthday, she woke up in her hotel room with a football player she didn't know.
I woke up because something wasn't right. There was someone inside me and touching me, and he was on top of me. And as drunk as I was and as tired as I was and passed out, I was trying to push him off me. But I couldn't, I didn't have the strength to push him off me. And I was drifting in and out of consciousness and that. And I think the alcohol, me being really, really tired, I just couldn't do anything about it.
Charmaine told us she was raped by a well-known NRL player. She didn't even consider going to the police.
Why would you go forward? You're about to be ridiculed and your name dragged through the mud, and you would be made out to be something that you're not and that you asked for it.
She says she was able to put it out of her mind, and it certainly didn't stop her pursuing other football players. Football is her life. So much so, she acts as a sort of clearinghouse, putting players and girls in touch through her Facebook.
I know it goes both ways because there's a lot of people that contact me from the players' side of things. I have players contacting me going, you know, I'm getting a lot of friend requests from your page. They're all female. They're all hot. Keep them coming. So they don't seem to mind.
The girls are equally direct.
I mean, there's heaps of girls who put pictures, you know, including myself, of, you know, you're in your bikinis and things like that, but the boys put pictures of themselves with no shirts on. Yeah, the girl, I mean, I love it. The girls love it. We comment on it all the time.
After Facebook comes the phone.
How do you know I know them? They ask you for your phone number.
They're here at my house now.
Then it's funny, they send you a photo. Like, they're very quick to send you a photo. And these aren't photos of just their face, because you already know what they look like.
Charmaine's been getting texts all afternoon from different NRL players.
Oh, right, that's pretty full on. On in that picture.
That's what we get heaps of.
You're kidding.
Heaps of.
Sorry.
That is probably the most...
The messages are pornographic.
That's what they send the most of. Like, you're very hard-pressed to get a picture of them just with no shirt on.
He's the hottest thing going around, and he's got, like, his jeans hanging down here.
There is an even more sinister side to this technology.
And you don't want any guys sitting there when you're...
Charmaine claims to have been shown a video recently by a young player on his mobile phone.
I don't know, I'm trying to find out.
And he goes, we picked up this one girl, and there was, like, seven of us on her and everything. And he goes to me, and we... But I said, you're going to get in trouble for that type of thing. Like, you can't do that. And he goes, please. He goes, we just filmed her to say that she consented to it. And that freaked me out. This girl was actually in her 20s. And he told me what they did to her. He said they made her put bunny ears on, because Easter's coming up, and made her give head to all of the players one after the other. Made. Like, I don't understand the term, like, we made her do it.
Yeah, and do you know who she is?
No, I asked him who she was.
Yeah.
Not knowing that I would even know her, and he goes, oh, just some slurry from around Cronulla.
To the extent that young women are finding themselves in a degrading situation, of course, we're appalled about that. And we do what we can to educate our players that that is wrong.
All the kids coming through will aspire to be here.
This is an NRL seminar on consent. Young players from Newcastle's under-20 team are shown two different stories.
So we'll have a look at the DVD, Maddie, if you can work that away.
In the first, a young woman goes home with two men and agrees to sex with one of them, not both.
What the fuck? Fuck
you! What do you think of the girl's role in this scenario? Anyone? Let's throw it in.
She put it out first.
She what?
She put it out first.
She put it out first? Yep, put it up there. Anything else?
She flirted with both of them.
Yeah. She what?
She flirted with both of them.
She flirted with both of them, yep. This guy, right, he's going to get in trouble. You think he's going to get in trouble?
Yeah.
What about the birthday boy? He get in trouble too?
Yeah. Depends how good his lawyer is.
Depends how good his lawyer is. We'll watch another one.
In the second version, a drunken man is subjected to homosexual rape. The responses from the players are very different.
All right, boys, birthday boy, what do you reckon? What do you think? How's he feeling? What happened? What happened to his night?
Shattered.
Do you think he had too much to drink?
Yeah.
You don't know,
sir. Too much to drink? What else? What about how he got into the situation and all that sort of stuff?
You ask for trouble if you have too much to drink and you get raped by a bloke. You don't ask for that.
Can we see there's some sort of double standard that may apply here? The girl's gone out to have a drink. No one said that she didn't ask for it. But yet the male goes out and has a drink. and it's crystal clear that he didn't ask for it.
The NRL says it's making progress, but judging by the final answer from this young player on recent scandals involving group sex, they still have a long way to go.
It's not during the act, it's the way you treat him after it. Most of them could have been avoided if they had put him in a cab and said, you know, thanks for that sort of thing, not just kicked her out and called her a dirty, whatever, and that sort of thing. It is how you treat him afterwards that covered a lot of that sort of stuff up.
In his 2006 book, Bad Boys, former coach Roy Masters writes frankly about how group sex was a way to create closer bonds between teammates.
What role does group sex play in team bonding?
I don't think it plays any role at all now, but in the past there can be little doubt that a girl that might have accommodated three or four players was all part of players becoming a closer knit unit, for want of a better word. I do think it in the past may well have been a focus of team players relating to each other.
Did you condone it as a coach?
No way, no.
And yet you can see that it had certain benefits.
Didn't I ever say that it had certain benefits? I said it has been a vehicle. It has been a vehicle of team bonding. It has been perceived as a vehicle of team bonding in the past.
And what makes you think it's no longer the case?
I think the Bulldog situation brought all of that to a head, that people were just saying, this is just dead set not on.
That Bulldog situation was the group sex scandal in 2004 at a Coffs Harbour resort that exposed this practice to a horrified public. It sparked a police investigation. Most of the team were interviewed, but no charges were laid. It was revealed that during the tour, a number of Bulldogs players had sex with a young woman whom they insulted and finally discarded. Bulldogs players commented at the time that gangbanging is nothing new, and some of the boys love a bun, their nickname for group sex. In the end, with no criminal charges to answer, the NRL was left to explain how this tawdry and demeaning practice had become part of the game's culture.
Was there no corporate memory, corporate knowledge in the NRL that this was a part of the culture of the game?
Oh, perhaps there was in some respects, but we're not part of club land. And to that extent, I don't think we would have the corporate knowledge that perhaps those who've been in club land or are in club land have got.
If the NRL, all the clubs, were surprised by the Bulldogs incident, they shouldn't have been. Four Corners can reveal that a remarkably similar incident had happened 2 years earlier. It involves the Cronulla Sharks and some of the biggest names in the game.
Would you be angry to learn that Cronulla had kept this incident from you?
It wouldn't be the first time that issues have been kept from the league.
In February 2002, the Cronulla Sharks took a large group of players on a pre-season tour to New Zealand. In Christchurch, they played against the Warriors. Soon afterwards, there were reports of an incident with a young woman at the team's hotel.
The Cronulla Sharks were in action in Christchurch last Sunday night.
It generated a few brief news stories in New Zealand and Australia.
We asked if they were aware of any incident that may have sparked such allegations, and they're certainly not aware of anything.
She's now resigned.
4 minutes of news footage, a blanket denial from the team's management, and the story disappeared from view. But not for the young woman involved. 7 years later, the pain is still raw.
I do get really upset sometimes, yeah, but I just... I don't think about it, and I still feel that it's my fault. I know it's not, but I feel that way.
I just try not to think about it, otherwise I get too upset.
You still think it might be your fault?
Just nothing ever happened, and no one's on my side, so that's just how I feel.
In 2002, 19-year-old Claire, as we'll call her, was working part-time as a waitress at the Racecourse Hotel on the outskirts of Christchurch. After finishing work, Claire went with two of the players back to their room. One of them started kissing her.
I didn't want to, make a big deal out of a kiss. And even though it was rough and disgusting, and I was a piece of meat even at that stage, but it was, it was nothing. It was just a kiss.
Over the next 2 hours, at least 12 players and staff came into the room. Six of them had sex with Claire. The others watched. 5 days after the event, Claire made a complaint to police.
It's a case that I do remember because of its extraordinary allegation.
Neville Jenkins was one of the officers on the case. 4 weeks after the complaint was made, 40 players and staff from Cronulla were interviewed by police. In their graphic descriptions, those present said she had consented to each and every act. No charges were laid. So it is the case that a large number of players and others in the Cronulla Sharks confirmed that group sex activity had taken place in that hotel.
There were people involved with the Cronulla Sharks and their supporting crew confirmed that there was sexual activity with this young woman.
Four Corners doesn't say that what took place in room 21 of the Racecourse Hotel was sexual assault. But a woman involved in degrading group sex can still be traumatised, whether she consents or not. In the course of the investigation, Jenkins formed an opinion of Claire.
She was a nice girl. She was young, naive, not worldly. Just a growing up teenager. But even for 19, she was quite young, I felt.
They were massive, like big rugby players. I felt like I just had no idea what to do. There was always hands on me, and there was always, if one person had stopped, someone was touching me and doing something else. There was never a point where I was not being handled. Every time I looked up, there would be more and more people in the room, and there's lots of guys in the room watching, maybe two or three that were on the bed that were doing stuff to me.
Can you try and tell me what some of those things were?
They flipped me over quite a bit and got out their penises and would put them on my face and stuff, and like maybe two guys would rub them on my face and things like that, and yeah.
What were the others doing while that was happening?
They were but masturbating themselves while watching.
The player she remembers best was there from the beginning.
I only remember this whole time, I only remember one player definitely. It was Maddie Johns.
Matthew Johns is an NRL personality. He was 30 at the time, a former Knights and State of Origin player. He's best known now for his role on the Channel 9 footy show.
And he's in a tackle and he's held. It's this one.
He told Four Corners he knew that one day this incident would catch up with him.
Let's go.
He laughed and he joked and he very loud and boisterous and thought it was hilarious and, you know, kept it going.
Matthew Johns and fellow player Brett Furman told Four Corners they were the first players to have sex with Claire. Furman said she was up for it 100%. Johns denies he kept it going, saying when he'd finished, he, quote, took a step back.
They never spoke to me. They spoke just to themselves, amongst themselves, laughing and thinking it was really funny, and when you have sex with someone, it's nice, and you talk, and you touch, and this was awful. This was nothing like that.
Some players even came into the room through the bathroom window.
I had my eyes shut a lot of it, and when I opened my eyes, there's just a long line at the end of the bed.
What was going through your mind when this was happening? Do you?
I thought that I was nothing. I thought I was worthless, and I thought I was nothing. And I think I was in shock. I didn't scream. And they used a lot of like mental power over me and belittled me and made me feel really small, like I was just a little old woman.
Towards the end, Paul Gallen, the current captain of the Cronulla Sharks, went in to see what was happening. Gallen told us it was pretty much all over by then, but nothing bad had happened anyway. After 2 hours, it ended.
I think maybe one of the guys said she's had enough, or something along those lines. Like, all right, guys, let's wrap it up. She's had enough. And so I put my clothes on and walked out
Did anybody talk to you while you were putting your clothes back on?
No one. I was nothing.
Afterwards, in the car park, Matthew Johns told Four Corners he went up to Claire and said he was sorry about the other guys coming into the room. The players continued with their careers. But 7 years ago, when the Cronulla caravan moved on from Christchurch, it left a young woman alone to deal with confusion and pain.
Well, for years and years afterwards, I was drinking a lot and crying a lot and losing a lot of friends and just doing quite destructive things to myself and to other people.
Did you continue with your studies?
I tried to, yeah, but I couldn't.
Did you know what was going on?
No, I just thought I was a useless person that I couldn't, like, I didn't care about anything, and I didn't really care what was happening.
How long did that last for?
Maybe four or five years or more. Still, to the end of it, I wasn't so much drinking heaps and heaps. I was more scared to go out of the house. I was a bit of a recluse. Didn't want to go out and see the world after that.
Yeah, I saw a young woman struggling with life. I didn't know prior to this episode, but presumably I'm led to believe that this is as a result of what happened to her at that time.
And has she called you for help at any time during these years?
Yes, she has.
And in what sort of state has she been?
Distressed.
The New Zealand Accident and Compensation Commission found that Claire was suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. Psychiatrists reported that she was suicidal, had cut her wrists several times, and bought a rope to hang herself with. The ACCC funded treatment for her, and gave her a weekly payment in compensation.
Do you think it will ever go away for you?
No, never, ever. No.
Why speak now?
I wanted at least their wives or girlfriends to know what they'd done, at the very least. Yeah.
Why did you want them to know?
Part of me wanted them to know because I was so angry and I wanted their lives destroyed, like mine was. And part of me wanted them to know so that they could go and meet and find better people that wouldn't treat them like that. Yeah.
What do you think about those people now?
What, if I had a gun, I'd shoot them right now. I hate them. They're disgusting. I want them dead. I hate them so much. Yeah. If I think about them. But I don't think about them.
It caused all parties enormous pain and embarrassment.
Matthew Johns used Channel 9's footy show last week to make a preemptive apology.
It's put my family through enormous anguish and embarrassment, and has once again, and for that I'm just, well, you can't say sorry enough.
But neither he nor any of the players we contacted asked about Claire. Charges laid.
But there has been a lot of pain and embarrassment to a lot of people.
All right, mate.
Well said. All right, let's get on with the show.
This young team, the Newcastle Knights, Matthew Johns' old club, suggests there is a better future for rugby league for any team that actually wants it. The clubs and the NRL have to clean out the old culture of exploitation and disdain for the game and for women like Caroline too.
I have vague hope that maybe something will change, that every season there isn't going to be another girl hiding with the curtains shut and the blinds down, hoping like hell that her name and her face isn't going to get out in the media. That it's not going to happen over and over, and that the football players involved and named aren't just going to go straight back on the paddock the next weekend, the next Saturday, or the next Friday night.
To view this program again, it will be available on iView from tomorrow by going to abc.net.au/fourcorners.
I'm Tracy Grimshaw. Welcome to A Current Affair. We begin with the interview Australia has been waiting to see. Last night I made it clear on this program TV star and footy legend Matthew Johns needed to address allegations about a group sex scandal in 2002. Today he was stood down indefinitely from all his on-air commitments with the Nine Network. Just a few hours ago, Matthew Johns and his wife Trish agreed to this exclusive interview. Matthew and Trish, thank you for your time. I know it's difficult for you to be here. I know you'd probably rather be anywhere else. Trish, I have to say at the start that I'm concerned for you. And if this gets too difficult for you at any point, please just feel free to leave. Why are you here?
I'm here because I know the truth of what happened. Matthew told me that 7 years ago when it all happened initially. And I believed him then, and we have worked through that over the years. And part of that was him being so blatantly honest with me about everything that happened that evening. And I just want to be here to support him.
Matthew, what do you say is the truth of what happened?
Well, Tracy, everything isn't in the police report. It's difficult for me to make comments at this time. I've just seen the footage of the Four Corners program, and I can see the fragile state that the woman is in. So I don't want to go into any intimate details that's going to cause her any more pain and embarrassment, and to be honest, any more pain and embarrassment to my family.
Did it distress you to see her condition?
Yes, it did. I made some comments last Thursday night on the footy show that I wasn't aware of what she'd been through. And I can say now, that any trauma and embarrassment that she's gone through as a result of this incident, I'm extremely sorry for. I'm extremely sorry for to my wife and my family as well, just the embarrassment and the pain it's caused them. It caused my wife enormous pain 7 years ago, and it's caused her enormous pain and public embarrassment now, 7 years later.
You see, there would be people who would be listening to you now saying, how could you be surprised at her trauma and her embarrassment, given that you were there on the night and you saw what she went through?
Again, without trying to cause any more embarrassment to the girl, I was there on the night and I did see what happened. And at no point did she object at any stage to what was going on.
What do you mean by that?
Is that 7 years ago when the incident went on, the woman was a willing participant in what went on. And it's something that I regret. I think it's something that all parties, including her, that she regrets as well now.
Are you saying that she shares some of the blame for what happened on that night? Is that your view?
I'm not looking, I've never blamed anyone else in this situation but myself. That's not blame, I've never looked to blame anybody else. That's not coming out as, I take full responsibility for the predicament that I find myself in.
Because she says that you were the instigator. She says that you were there in the room the whole time. She says that she was virtually ignored. None of the players who were lining up at the end of the bed acknowledged her, spoke to her.
Totally untrue.
Do you say that she was the instigator?
I would say that on the night when she came back to the room, she was a willing participant in everything that occurred. And I feel great sorry for the pain and regret she's felt in the aftermath of that, the subsequent pain. But again, I have to say that she was a willing participant in what occurred.
And yet she went back to the room with two of you, didn't she? How could she, in going back to the room with two of you, have ended up being a willing participant in a queue of blokes at the foot of the bed having sex with her?
Well, at the time when I went back, I was totally unaware that other people were coming into the room. At the point that they did, I stepped away from it. In the statements that were made to the police, it says that She encouraged players to come forward, and then she actually said, "Will someone come forward now?" To the words of "Will someone hurry come forward and have sex with me?" at which one player said he would, and she said, no, no, anyone but you, and pointed to me again, which I declined.
So are you saying that you became uncomfortable when the other men started filing into the room, the other players?
After I declined, I stepped out of the room. But I stepped back in to make sure that everything was okay, that she was not under any distress, and at no time was she under any distress.
You see, Matthew, most right-thinking people would be listening to you right now saying, how could you have looked at that scenario and seen anything that was okay in it?
Morally, it's not okay.
She was 19 years old. She was naked. She was outnumbered. There was a very clear power imbalance in that room, wasn't there?
Tracy, I was unaware that she was 19 at the time, but again, she gave no indication that she did not want to be there.
Isn't there something in your mind that says, this is wrong, on every level? This is a vulnerable woman. She wants more from this situation than we're ever going to give her. And this is just wrong.
Morally, it is wrong. It is wrong, I'm aware of that. But at the time, the woman was a willing participant in what went on, and it was unsavoury. But police completely investigated the situation and there was no case to answer.
Where are those other players who have regrets? Why haven't they stepped up? Why are they allowing you to take all of the heat? You were not the only man in that room.
I can't answer that. The only thing I'll say is that from the first day that this occurred, I'll be completely honest with the New Zealand police. I was completely honest with my wife, and even when the ABC reporter rang me up, I was completely honest with her.
You see, the problem is that the public have had enough of this sort of behaviour. People have had enough of it. This notion of group sex, this practice of bunning, is unsavoury, it's distasteful. People reject it, and yet it seems to be so embraced by players.
I can only speak for myself, Tracy, and that's 7 years ago, and everybody's got something in their life they regret and they'd love to rewind and take away, and that's mine.
Did you confess to Trish because the police had interviewed you, or would you have told her otherwise?
I confessed to Trish because I felt otherwise. I was embarrassed. Completely embarrassed about it. I had two sons and I felt enormous guilt.
Were you worried that she was going to find out some other way?
There's probably a part of me that believed that she deserved to know and deserved to find out.
What did you say when he told you, Trish?
I was completely shocked. It was extremely out of character for Matt. I was horrified and disgusted and just shocked that he would have even been involved in such a thing. But he told me very specifically every last detail of his involvement in that actual incident, and I believed him. And my inquisition went on probably for months and possibly years. Questions would come up again and again, and that was part of our arrangement. If we were going to continue with our marriage, that he had to be terribly honest with me, because otherwise we could never continue with our marriage, and lack of trust.
Was it just his infidelity that horrified you, or was it the circumstances?
It was the circumstances, but probably primarily the infidelity. And the greatest thing that I feel is that Matt's greatest, knowing all of the information that I do, is that his greatest crime is actually being unfaithful to me as his wife. And I feel that it's only for me to judge him on that. And whether that's someone in football or everyday people or the businessman or someone working at Channel 9 or whatever, anyone committing adultery to their wife, that is between a husband and a wife.
Matt, do you still believe that your greatest crime is your infidelity to Trish, or do you believe that you committed, perhaps not a crime, but you committed an act of abuse to that woman?
I did not commit an act of abuse to that woman. I'm guilty of infidelity to my wife and guilty of absolute stupidity.
So what do you make of what she said in that interview? Because there is an enormous disparity between what she says happened on that night and what you are saying happened on that night.
Tracy, I can't comment on her thoughts or her comments. I don't know. I think that the woman walked away from the situation with enormous regrets, like everybody else, and embarrassment.
Let's say that she offered herself in that scenario. Let's say that that's right. If I suggested to you that the women who do that are actually looking to feel special for a while, they see you all as sports gods and they want a little bit of your fame and your adulation and your specialness to rub off on them, how would you view that?
Tracy, I don't know how to answer that.
Because if this is such a common practice, and we understand that it is, you all must wonder why these women, if it's the case, why these women offer themselves. You all must wonder about that.
Okay, that's not for me to comment.
Tell me how you viewed her on that night. Did it occur to any of you that the girl on the bed was somebody's sister, somebody's daughter, a girl with hopes and dreams and aspirations of her own?
At the time, no, you don't think. No, it's fair to say we didn't think like that, no.
Is it about time that players started thinking like that?
Tracy, this is, this is not about, I'm not here to talk about other players or other players' morals or how they think. It's about the mistake I made of getting involved with that situation.
I understand that you feel you can talk about yourself in this, but you have a perfect opportunity right now to step up and send a message to other players about this culture. This is your opportunity, Matt.
Tracy, I would say to players, it's a situation where let's look for the right words. The situation where things occur which are dangerous and they're stupid, and you make decisions that you most certainly will regret later, with at the time you give no thought to. But Tracy, at the moment, as much as I love the game of rugby league and the people who play it, my thoughts and my energies are directed towards my family and what the pain I've caused them.
And what about to this girl?
For the pain and the trauma that she's felt out of all this and the embarrassment, I'm truly sorry. It's caused a lot of pain and embarrassment to a lot of people.
Trisha, how do you view this girl, this woman?
It's a very, very difficult question for me to answer clearly. I certainly wouldn't like it to be my daughter.
If you had that time again, Matt, what would you do?
For seven years I've thought about just simply not walking into that room. And wished I hadn't.
Have you waited for 7 years for this to bite you?
7 years ago, when for 7 years, I've had fears that this would become public, and it would cause the huge pain and embarrassment to my family, and more than that, it caused enormous pain to my wife first of all, but the public embarrassment, and I always feared that. Sometimes when the phone would ring, I'd have feared that it was someone to ring and ask about that. When I got the call from the Four Corners journalist, all the years of sitting in fear and worrying about that, at first, when she said what she was ringing about, I was shocked. And then strangely, it was strange, almost at the same time, I was a relief because I saw it as an opportunity to finally ending that chapter of my life and ending all the fear.
If you had known that girl was 19, would you have taken part in it?
No. No, I regret that. If I had my time again, Tracy, I'd never taken part in it.
What effect has this had on you these last few days, both of you?
Well, primarily, we took the children away. We have two young boys, and I didn't want them subjected to any of this. And then Matt joined us after his work commitments. And it's pretty much been living hell, I would imagine, would be the best way of describing it.
Matt?
The toughest thing for me is just seeing the pain it's caused my wife, and just facing my children, looking at my children, and seeing the pain it's caused the woman as well. All those things, it's been hell.
Well, you've lost your career to speak of. You came awfully close to losing your marriage. What do you do now?
Well, I've got to go away and make it up to my wife and make it up to my family. That's where my priorities lay. As far as my career at Channel 9, that's the furthest thing from my mind at the moment.
Does he have some rebuilding to do with you, Trish?
Not so much. I don't think we did the rebuilding over the past 7 years. I think, if anything, this recent event has actually just brought us closer.
All right. I know it's been difficult to talk. Thank you for your time. I don't know if that interview will give any comfort to that young woman in New Zealand, and I'm not sure if anything can. But what needs to happen now is for the league to identify all of the other players who were in that room if it is serious about addressing this culture. Matthew Johns has taken the rap, and rightly so, but he's done it alone, and he clearly was not alone on that night.
Oh, we've got another game. Yeah. Of course we have, yes. Where's those Logies? Are they still up? No, they're not. The Roosters taking on the Knights. And who are you booing? Who are you booing?
The Roosters!
The Knights are probably one of the informed teams in the comp along with the Bulldogs. Deserve to be favourites. I like the Knights. I think they're playing great football. The Roosters.
Stick with them.
They were terrible Monday night.
One more chance for Mitchell Pearce to have his say. Look, he is actually the incumbent New South Wales halfback from an Origin perspective. He replaced the injured Peter Wallace last year but missed out on City Country. He gets his chance against Jared Mullen. I'm expecting a huge game from Mitchell and I'm expecting a very close contest, but I'll go with the Knights.
I think Peter Wallace does have that spot sewn up. I don't know that this is the understudy role, is it, between Jared Mullen and...
Injuries can happen. Lock it happen in 2 weeks.
Yeah, Franklin. No, that's true. I'm gone the Knights. I think they're in form.
Oh, yeah, please, fire up, Gus. I know it's past your bedtime.
Yeah, right. I know you're a bit drained.
I'm a bit tired, but the Knights I tipped at the start of the year to make the top four, and even then I thought, geez, I'm being adventurous, but the more I see of them, the more I like of them, and I don't think any team feels comfortable playing against this side, and I think the Knights will win pretty handsomely this week.
How good, Brian Smith is, he's almost the coach of the year so far.
He has always been a great coach. Yeah. He has always been a great coach, and back in the days when I was coaching, he was one of the real rivals that you had to be on your game with. I've always loved coaching against him. I've loved the sides that he's coached. He's come in some bad raps at times, but hasn't he been proven right up there? Crikey.
He's going good.
Andrew John goes back down the right side with Kidley.
The Roosters would give for a result like that here tonight, what they'd give to have that man, Brad Fittler, of course, back on deck, scoring tries of intercepts, throwing cutout balls for tries. A famous game here at the Football Stadium. The two sides meet once again tonight to kick off two games on Super Saturday. It's the Roosters up against the Knights, a half-hour pre-game show, of course, before our kick-off at 5:30. Hello, everybody. Warren Smith alongside Greg Alexander to take you through our pre-game show. And, Brandy, it's a big game for both sides, of course, but the Roosters in particular have only won one from four here at the Football Stadium so far in 2009. Losing last week at Gosford was also a home game. They're one from five in their home games. They need to start winning. And start winning soon.
Well, we have been saying that for a number of weeks now. The Roosters, they certainly need a win here tonight up against the Newcastle team that are travelling quite well. In terms of attacking football, I don't think they're any better than Newcastle so far after around nine rounds in this season.
Now let's turn our attention quickly to the Newcastle Knights and their coach, Brian Smith. They've won five from their last six, and here is the coach once again speaking to Greg.
Brian, a win today will put you on top of the competition, albeit with a couple of other clubs. It's been a pretty good month and a bit of football.
Yeah, we've done pretty well. We've been reasonably consistent this year, but we're only a third of the way through and we've got another tough game away from home today.
You got the points last week against the Gold Coast, but it wasn't a great 80-minute effort. What was the focus this week?
Yeah, trying to improve that, really. You know, we were disappointed. I think that's a bit of a measure of where we're at. You know, we're not capable of probably playing at our best level all the time, but certainly want to get there today. I've got a feeling it's going to be pretty rugged, very physical early on in this game today, so I'd like to think we can get a good start.
You're back to the halves combination you started with Jared Mullen and Ben Rogers. Scott Duro drops out of the side. I read that you weren't happy with the three of them last week. What do you think, what needs to happen a bit more often today to improve?
Certainly like to see an improvement in our kicking game. We were a bit poxy in that regard last week. And generally our support play and probably overall just control and dominance of the game when it comes our way. You know, they're all three of them are young fellas still making their way in the game, so I'm not jumping up and down, and we're doing pretty well. Scotty's probably a bit unlucky this week, but one of them sort of had to be this week, I guess.
You got some class players that the media seem to focus on, but you know as well as anyone else that there's always some other players that are just as important in the team. I think a couple of those that have had good years so far, Richie Faiso off the bench, and also Zeb Taylor, underrated, but certainly not by you.
No, all those guys have been doing a good job. Our forward pack's been pretty solid all year for us. I'd add Chris Houston to that. I think Chris is a bit of an understated player. He's one of those blokes that does a lot of communicating both during the match and before and after. He's a pretty heady sort of player, and he brings a fair bit to the table that helps the guys coordinate their effort, which, I'm an appreciator of that sort of talent.
Brian, all the best today.
Thanks.
Brian Smith there with Brandy. Here is the Knights side, of course, and they've once again lost both Adam McDougall and Cooper Vuna comes into the side for Aku Uwate. So Keith Alia is the replacement for Adam McDougall. Vuna gets his first run of the season after tearing a medial ligament and also damaging his anterior cruciate ligament in the pre-season. They're both in the side in jumpers 18 and 20 respectively. Richie Faoso, speaking of him, gets a chance in the starting side with Danny Wicks also coming in with both front rowers, Mark Tafua and Chris Houston going back to the bench for Brian Smith.
Yeah, look, they've lost a couple of big men early in the season. Dan Toller and Ben Cross has gone for the season. So they've done good. They've done a good job, his big men. Tafua and Houston will start off the bench. Look, Lalia and Vuna, I don't think they lose much in there. Uwate's a terrific player, but Cooper Vuna had a fantastic season last year, and as you said, only not playing because of injury in the trial games. And Lalia, we saw him in action last week, and also I thought he was very good against the Dragons defensively, did a great job, and that was on the wing, but he'll play centre tonight. So even though they've lost some players, the players stepping into the breach are quite handy.
He can be a damaging ball runner, can't he? Cooper Vuna can certainly find the trial line. We'll take a look at his form tonight here and see how it turns out. It was interesting to see the Newcastle Knights wearing the old Henny Penny jumpers, if you like, from when they came into the comp back in 1988. After in the same game last year, they wore the more traditional Newcastle district jumpers with the red and white hoops.
I'm happy with the Henny Penny.
So am I. It reminds me more of the Newcastle Knights. They looked a bit too much like the Dragons in that particular game last year.
If I see that jersey, I think of Salmon Slam Stewart.
Sam Stewart.
Slam and Sammy.
Wasn't he a great Newcastle Knight, of course, when they came into the comp back in 88. Let's take a look at the ladder now after a couple of games in round 10. And the Bulldogs still would be disappointed after that result last night. The controversial loss as it's turned out to the Dragons, but they sit there on 14 points with the Broncos, who were winners over the Titans last night. The Dragons, they're also on 14. The Knights can join them on 14 points with a win here to go to 7 wins for the season with a victory over the Roosters. The Roosters in 15th, a 3-6 record, and they really have struggled, as we said previously, here at home so far this season. They need to score some points and shut out the Knights. That has been tough for them to do so far in 2009. We'll take a break right now. The Knights are on the field warming up. We'll come back to preview some of the star players for both camps in just a moment on Super Saturday. Certainly got revenge. We showed you that win, of course, in the prelim final in 2000. The Roosters getting the cash over the Newcastle Knights here off the top of the pregame show. Well, that one they got back in spades, of course. A massive scoreline there for the Newcastle Knights over the Roosters. It turned out to be the last game in the coaching career at the Roosters of Graham Murray. Of course, Ricky Stewart came in the next year. They went on to win the comp.
There we go, and Newcastle went on to win the comp that year.
Yeah, exactly right, of course. Okay, to the Newcastle Knights now, of course, who are in the first year of the post-Danny Badiris era, if you like, after they lost Andrew Johns not that long before that. Stepping up into Danny Badiris' shoes as far as captaincy full-time this season was Kurt Gidley. We knew what a good player he's always been.
has jumped into that captaincy role and relished it.
Yeah, look, it will be the first player chosen for New South Wales and probably will be captain for New South Wales too. No one runs more or runs as far in a game of football than Kurt Gidley. He's just fantastic. Brian Smith must love having a bloke like him in the side and captain. That's a part of his game that probably has been underrated so far this year. Come out with more try saves than any other fullback in the game. So just such an important cog for this Newcastle side, and he will be for New South Wales too.
Yeah, as you said, more than likely the captain for New South Wales in this upcoming Origin series. We'll wait and see that side to be announced in just two games' time as far as the Newcastle Knights are concerned. So we're getting close to seeing who will play for New South Wales and Queensland in game one of this year's Origin series on the 3rd of June. Game one, of course, coming up from Etihad Stadium down there in Melbourne. Now, Isaac de Goyce was a big off-season signing for the Newcastle Knights, and he certainly turned out to be the player that Brian Smith was hoping he could be for the Knights, and here he is having a chat with Greg.
Isaac, nine rounds into the competition, be pretty happy with your move to Newcastle so far?
Yeah, mate, it's going all right. You know, we're up there in the mix, where we wanted to be at the start, and, we're going good, yeah.
Brian Smith's got you playing some attractive football. When you went from Cronulla to Newcastle, did you have to change your game? What's Brian Smith want out of a dummy half?
Yeah, change a bit. He wants more attacking role from me, and I've got a lot of improving to do. And I'm working on it on combos with Gids and Mullo, and mate, hopefully I'll just keep getting better and better.
In today's game, the Roosters desperate. They've got some quality players. You'd be wary of that.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, they I think they won from five in the last, you know, games, and they'll be very desperate, very hard to beat up here in their home ground. So, you know, we've got to be on the ball, and hopefully we come away with the 2 points.
Play well, Isaac.
Thanks, mate. Cheers.
Brian Smith said in the pre-season he was always a massive Isaac de Goyce fan from the time he saw him playing a junior rep match for the West Magpies. Of course, he kicked it off in the NRL with the Tigers, went to the Sharks, has fitted in beautifully here in the Newcastle Knights lineup, though.
Yeah, big shoes to fill, aren't they, Danny Badiris's, but he's certainly done as well as he can, Isaac de Goyce. Great out of dummy half, knows when to take advantage of a quick play, the ball and some lazy markers. Very strong in defence, as we've just seen from that hit on Chris Walker. And there he is taking advantage. Can earn his side a penalty, running at the markers. And he said something pretty important. He's working on his combinations. And look, he's only nine games into a career with Newcastle and working on those combinations with the halfback and the fullback, which are so vital for a team.
Yeah, Brian Smith said he knew he could squid from dummy half. That was a given from what he'd seen, of course, in his time at the Sharks. But he wanted him to be more involved with the players one and two off the ruck, and he certainly has developed that part of his game, it would seem, in Newcastle in 2009. Now, Chris Houston was a player who had to perhaps eliminate some stuff from his game, and that was the fact that he used to be a bit of a narc with the referees and give away penalties at times. And boy, if he's lost that side of his game, he's picked up plenty of metres and tackle-busting ability so far this season.
Well, look, I think Brian Smith got that out of his game, and no doubt Brian Smith was so impressed and made him a key signing at the beginning of last year. He's a great athlete. He's got plenty of speed. He's playing up front now. He can play back row or up front, and just such a damaging ball runner. Just the angle he runs, we've just seen that. He can play on the edges, he can offload, and there he is going through a hole that he can hit, and he knows where to run for his ball player. So he's just a fantastic forward to have, Chris Houston, just a great athlete.
He'll give him some punch coming off the bench. He'll wear that starting jumper tonight, number 10, but will come off the bench as we saw that reshuffled lineup for Brian Smith here tonight. Now, a couple of moments ago, we mentioned it is just two games before the New South Wales lineup will be named for Origin 1, and while Housen probably won't be in that side, somebody who could very well be, given the form he showed, especially playing in the City Country game just over a week ago now, is James McManus. He's a bit of a bolter, but don't be surprised if he snares a blue jumper.
Well, he's an Origin style of winger, isn't he? He's fantastic out of dummy half, James McManus. Very strong, certainly put on a lot of size in the last 18 months. He's the Newcastle's top try scorer. He's crossed five times this year. And I'm sure it's what they're thinking of when they're thinking New South Wales winger. James McManus, very safe, solid under the high ball, and his dummy half running was not many better than him.
There are a few contenders, of course, along with Joel Monaghan and also Jared Hayne, but James McManus certainly has put himself right amongst the thick of it as far as those Origin selections go. For the Blues, for Origin 1.
I'm going to say the Newcastle Knights is your tip, but by any flash margin?
No, I think the Roosters are fired up tonight. I've just got a feeling that they are desperate. They know how important the 2 points are. I think they'll fire up, but I think Newcastle just have too much class. They've shown so far this year that they can be as good as anyone with the ball.
Yeah, they have won five from their last six. We'll see if they can go on with the job and join those teams above them on 14 points on the NRL ladder. We're not too far away from a kickoff. Make sure you stick around. It is the Roosters up against the Knights next.
Meanwhile, in tonight's first game, the Roosters are desperate to find some form, but at halftime against the Knights, they trail 22-0. And it didn't start well for the Roosters. Soliola was carried off after injuring his knee. Then Gidley saw a chance and Taya forced his way over. The Knights stormtrooper had his second just a few minutes later.
Newcastle can join a four-way tie on the top of the ladder this evening. They lead the Roosters 22-0 at half-time. It was a bad start for the home side. Sears Soliola suffered a leg injury and was carried off. Kurt Gidley went close for the Knights, but Willie Mason saved the try with his knees. The Newcastle captain put Zeb Taya over for the first try.
They surely have to score this time, they will.
Newcastle were ahead 12-0 after Taya's second converted try.
And the Knights have beaten the Roosters in an absolute canter here this evening. 38-6. Brian Smith says, well done, boys. They got the job done comfortably here tonight. And they make it yet another 2 points to their tally. They are flying high, the Knights. Unfortunately, the Roosters, well, not in the wooden spoon position. It's only the Sharks propping it up at the moment off the bottom of the table. But they are in all sorts of trouble, the Knights, though. Terrific once again.
Yeah, fantastic effort by the Knights. Really dominant first half. Brian Smith will be pleased with how his boys played. He wasn't too happy with their performance against the Gold Coast Titans. Even though they picked up the points, there he goes, the happy coach up the tunnel. But fantastic performance, that man on camera now, Kurt Gidley. Well, that's one of the best individual games, apart from spilling that ball and robbing himself of a four-pointer. What a performance by him. Jordan Tansey, the man on camera, was good for the Knights, for the Roosters. But gee, the possession rate, it hurt them in the first half, and it continued in the second half.
That it did. 22 blot it was at half-time. Cooper Vuna, well, he's all smiles. He gets a try after making a comeback from what was potentially a very serious knee injury. He's been able to rehab it and come back here in round 10. He's got 4 points and 2 points for the Knights to show for it. Let's go downstairs to Scotty Sadler.
Well, I'm here with Kurt Gidley. And, Kurt, well, you kept the pressure and intensity on for the whole game, which will impress Brian Smith.
Yeah, I think it's the first time I've done it all year. You know, with the three games we've been beating him, we've been leading at half-time. So I think that's probably our best yet.
What is your role from Brian Smith? Is it a roving role, or is it just that you're hyperactive? Because you're just in such a dominant performance from you here tonight.
Yeah, I enjoy doing, you know, a few things, jumping into dummy half or playing something structured from a tap. But get a ball playing, I enjoy everything, mate.
What happened at the end? The line wide open, were you thinking about the backflip at the end of the try, or what happened?
I wasn't. Sometimes when it comes too easy, it's the hardest one, so I'm pretty filthy on it, actually.
Well done on tonight, mate. Great performance.
Thanks, mate.
Also, Jared Marlin. Jared, the forwards, they keep setting a really good platform. Makes it easier for you, doesn't it?
Yeah, mate, they're unbelievable. They're laying the platform for us. So it's making us easy for our halves and the outside backs to, you know, keep scoring them tries.
It's a combination with Benny Rogers again this week. He's taking a bit of pressure off not only Kurt Gidley, but yourself and also Isaac, isn't he?
Yeah, mate, he's running the ball good. He's putting the defence in two minds, and he's creating a lot for us. So, mate, he's playing great footy.
And yourself, with Origin coming up, it sets up a good scene next week out of the cold of Sydney into the warmth of North Queensland up again. Jonathan Thurston coming to Origin. It's a good time for yourself.
Oh, mate, definitely. You know, you love to test yourself against the best, and I love to test myself out there against Pearson tonight. And, mate, he's a great player, so I'm always up for the challenge.
What about Gidley? He's a freak, isn't he?
He's unbelievable, mate. He's the fittest man in rugby league, and I'm glad he's on our team.
Well done tonight, mate. Good luck next week against the Cowboys.
Cheers, bud.
Jared Mullen, another very good game here tonight. The Knights fans have come down to the fence to congratulate They're heroes. They've got the job done comprehensively against the Roosters. We'll take a break and come back to wrap it up on the first instalment of Super Saturday tonight. There's a lot more to come. Stick around.
And we saw the Knights come up with an outstanding performance last night against the Roosters. We'll break and come back and have a look how Kurt Gidley led his side to a big win.
Grabbed by Marco Mealy. Gidley, seeing there was only one marker, splits them to go down the field once again. A ball out the back for Rogers. He'll go for the line. A ball over the top for Cullen. And the Knights at their spectacular best.
With the Roosters desperate for a win and a top of the table spot up for grabs for Newcastle, both teams came out firing. But it wasn't long before the Knights showed why they're one of the form teams of this year's competition.
They surely have to score this time, they will.
Minutes later, Zeb Teo crossing for his second.
Rogers goes in behind them. Teo will bounce away from the defence and score his second.
With Mullen and 5'8 Ben Rogers combining well, the Knights were making plenty of inroads down the Roosters' left wing. But it was a 70-metre run from Gidley that gave the visitors their third try leading into half-time.
Rogers, he'll go for the line. A ball over the top for Mullen. And the Knights at their spectacular best.
The Roosters finally gave the home supporters something to cheer about early in the second half.
Fitzgibbon, he gives it off for Jordan Tansey. Just how fast is he? He's quick enough and they can chase, but they won't get to him, Mullen! And the death just about did!
But it came at a price. Craig Fitzgibbon injured and forced from the field. The Roosters' joy was, however, short-lived. Mullen crossing for his second.
Behind them and then bouncing across. We're going to check it
to see if it was a double movement. He says try, Jaron Mullen.
The Knights stretching their lead again 10 minutes from time.
One here from Hilda, who comes up with an offload. He beat Lapini Payer. He comes towards Tansey. Now Mullen. He had Danny Wicks with him. He said, give me the ball. Werner's there. He gets a chance to score.
And the final blow coming from Danny Wicks.
Go to Danny Wicks, who splits them.
Kurt Gidley and Jared Mullen doing nothing to hurt their Origin campaigns on what was a miserable night for Brad Fittler's side, slumping to their seventh defeat of the season.
And it was by 32 points, three in a row now for the Knights. The Roosters remain 15th on the competition ladder. Always look well prepared. They look confident, Joey, your old mob, and a lot to like about them at the moment.
Oh, they're flying at the moment, Sterlo. As you said, well prepared. The belief within the club, Gidley, Mullen, they got the class there, but it's the lesser lights, the players especially under the radar are just flying.
Kurt Gidley, his form last night, Roosters against the Knights. This is an outstanding performance by a bloke that right now you could give him any number in any team and he will do a job and do it very well.
Unbelievable player. I said this about a month ago. If you want a captain for your Origin team, Kurt Gidley's the man. Leads from the front, he's always in the game, good ambassador. But not just that, look at him, he's in everything.
Fit.
Yeah, he is fit, and he's one of those players that you want in your team. And I'll be honest, my two favourite players in the league at the moment are him and Ben Cray. I just love the way they play.
Last week, MG, you suggested Kurt Gidley 5'8 for New South Wales, given that you weren't so convinced about the number sixes on show in City Country. Thoughts right at the moment, as we're only two rounds away?
No doubt he'll be in the side as captain, so you can play him anywhere, but I still think he's a 5'8". I'd like to put either Luke Patton or young Morris from the Dragons at fullback, Wade McKinnon. I think fullback he can cover, but I think he's got to have his hands on the ball more times than any bloke in the game, because I think he's, if you ask the Queensland backline who they fear more out of him or Campuzzi, I note through the week that Darren Lockyer said they've got to pick Campuzzi. I think that might be a little bit of a reverse psychology. I think if Gidley was 5'8", they'd be more worried.
Gus, yeah, you can have the last call on 5-8.
I know
you like an Astor, but
yeah, I don't think it's at all fair to play Gidley 5-8. I think he's been playing fullback for his club. If he's going to play Origin, he should play in his position. Mm. I don't think 5-8 is going to be his spot in Origin. Personally, it's an Astor. I mean, I think he's the 5-8, but outside of that, I think Mullen is the one with the link to Gidley that might get him a start there. He'd be better suited playing outside of Wallace than I think Campese would.
What about from a Queenslander's perspective? Who would they least like to play at 5-8, do you think, Dale?
Oh, no, I don't think they really care, but...
honestly,
they don't care with their back one. They wouldn't really care, but... Yeah, look, mate, honestly, I wouldn't know, probably. Terry Campese, probably.
Mm. Now, Gus, you're a huge fan of Brian Smith, admirer of his work.
And so another one, Terry Campese.
He can't keep a straight face.
I'm not sweating, I'm honest.
He's not sweating up. No, I'm right. Not sweating up. It's amazing, that first segment. Right, now, let's talk about Brian Smith, because you've been a great fan of his. And I think which is highlighted, and last night we got some highlights of Zebulon Taya, to roll into our fans watching the program. How he gets the best out of players, and I will say this with the greatest of respect, marginal players when they're signed by the club. And I include Richie Faioso in that. I would even say Denny Wicks in that. And Zeb Taya certainly in that category. Almost bit part players, he has got them playing out of their skins, Gus. What's his secret?
Yeah, and it goes to show too how lucky some players can be or how unlucky they can be, the type of coach or environment they get.
Indeed.
Because there are a lot of players you never really realise their potential. They're outstanding juniors, come through the rep program, they're dominant at certain ages, but never quite find their footing in first grade. Mm. And the ability of Brian Smith is always to be able to look at a player and say, well, he's got these abilities, I know where I can fit that in to my team. And I can make him believe that he fits into the team, and I can help him understand how important his role is. And that gives the kid confidence. And I think Brian Smith's always had the ability to convince a player that he has exactly what he's looking for. Mm. You've got exactly what I want. What you do is exactly what we need. And this is going to benefit because, and these players are going to tap into you and you'll be able to tap into them. And all of a sudden you've got a team. And with Newcastle, are one of the sides in the competition that really look like a team. The Dragons are another one. Now, if you compare the Dragons the last couple of years, you know, probably even with better rosters, compared to the Dragons now, and you've only got to look at them and know they're more of a team. And that's what Brian Smith has always been able to create. And he doesn't look at scrapbooks, but he looks at the player's ability, what he can do, and he says, I can use that. And not only that, I can convince the kid that he's valuable.
Well, I'll give you another one. Denny Wicks, MG. Let's talk about Denny Wicks.
And Ben Rogers as well.
Well, Ben Rogers into the category as well. Last night, you see a leaner, meaner, fitter Denny Wicks. And we're going to show you in a moment a try he scored against the Roosters last year as well.
Yeah, well, at the moment, Denny Wicks owns the Roosters, doesn't he? Because he scored two great tries against them in exactly the same round, or heritage rounds last year as well. But he seems a lot leaner this year, big Denny Wicks.
This is last year.
This is the try. The bell's gone. Willie won't want to see this. Through Sammy Parrott, who's a great defender as well. And the big fella just goes over. And he scored a try this year. Like a basketball, he leapt, or like an AFL player, he leapt up, and he's got such great agility. But he's just one of them players who's come along so much under Brian Smith.
Players, the big difference between a player being successful or unsuccessful or realizing his potential, it all comes down to confidence. You know, some people are born with it. They're born with confidence and trust their own ability. Others need it instilled in them. And you know that. You've played with blokes. And some coaches can do it. They're really good at it. And Brian Smith is one of those sort of blokes. That's a player. There's a couple of players in his side that if they're playing elsewhere, you may not see the impact that you're getting. Mm.
But even the Dragons boys, they were saying about Danny Wicks, they said naturally very gifted. Like over the 40 metres, he was one of the quicker players at the club. But to be honest, no disrespect to Danny, but they said he was lazy. Mm. You know, you get there under Brian Smith, and if you don't fit into his regime, mate, see you later. So it's
conversely, we heard the same things about Michael Wayman at Canberra.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Everyone says he's such a good player, a bit lazy. Goes to the Dragons and all of a sudden he's their main man.
Well, I'm pretty honest. I said to him when he came in, I thought he was like just a big angry bloke who was a bully and who used to get suspended all the time. Yeah. And to be honest, he's one of the most loveliest blokes off the field, him and his beautiful fiancée, Alison. And they've been great for the club.
The other thing too is, you know, when players come into first grade, a lot of them think they're one mistake away from getting dropped.
Yeah.
If I make a mistake or I try something and it doesn't work, I'm going to get dropped.
Eggshells.
What Brian Smith, he encourages that. He encourages them to be a little bit you know, investigative about the way they play and a little bit flamboyant. And if it doesn't come off, well, then we'll come back and talk about it later. But I'm not going to drop you for it.
Well, the player there is Richie Feoso, because he dead set, you've used the expression hands like a dolphin's flippers, but Richie Feoso had errors in him. You know, he had handling errors under pressure off his own goal line, made a lot of errors, had a lot of clubs. And when Newcastle picked him, he thought, well, what's he going to get out of you? There isn't a player in the game now running the ball harder than Richie Feoso. He is bending defensive lines back.
Yeah.
He's exceeding anything that he's shown.
You know why? Because everyone was telling him before what bad hands he was or what a mistake factory was. Brian Smith says, geez, I like the way you run. And now he didn't have to pass or catch it or do it. All he had to do was run hard with it, and he'll build his game around that.
He actually had hands like a broken clock.
Lovely stuff. Very emotional. Look, just one last wrap to finish this segment to a young bloke who's done it tough, and he's got a few issues off the field at the moment, but we saw him at the ground last night, Corey Patterson. And I'll tell you what was good about this, is seeing the young bloke with a smile on his face, and we hope Corey's back playing in the grade ranks soon. As I say, he's got a few issues to deal with off the field, but he's a tremendous talent. We've seen that. And let's hope that everything is back on track. Good luck to you, Corey.
Roosters were blown away by Newcastle in the opening half.
They surely have to score this time, they will.
It's Kurt Gidley's nimble feet and crafty hands plotting their downfall.
A ball over the top for Mullen.
Well, the crowd is going rugby league at the moment. It's just nice to watch Kurt Gidley play footy, I think. Week in, week out, he does the same thing each week. He's been doing it for a couple of years.
The Knights winning 38-6. The Roosters lost the game. Craig Fitzgibbon for a fortnight with an ankle injury. And Sia Soliola for up to 6 weeks with a ligament tear in his knee. Paul Cochran, 10 News.
Newcastle ran riot against the Roosters. The Knights confirming their premiership contenders.
Ball out the back for Rogers. He'll go for the line. A ball over the top for Mullen.
Kurt Gidley bound to be first picked for the Blues, the Knights' number one, hailed by both coaches.
He's in the peak of his career, I would say, right now.
Well, the crowd is going rugby league at the moment. It's just nice to watch Kurt Gidley play footy, I think.
The Bulldogs still top the table despite that controversial loss to the Dragons. The Rabbitohs up to fifth spot. The Storm and Raiders play tomorrow night. Andrew McKinlay, 9 News.
And the Knights on Monday Night Football.
Welcome along to the pre-game show on Bundy Rum's Monday Night Footy. Tonight, all eyes are on Knights captain Kurt Gidley to see whether he's recovered from a recent knee infection. Experts are saying he'll be named captain of the Blues side a little later tonight. Now, there's his teammate, Jared Mullen. He's also in the running for Origin 1. First up, though, a mouth-watering battle with Queensland's halfback Jonathan Thurston as they face the informed Cowboys tonight. It is going to be an absolute cracker. G'day, everyone. Ryan Phelan with you again for the Bundy pre-game show on the panel. As always, Gordon Tallis, Gary Freeman and Wayne Pearce. G'day, boys. Look, it's a big night tonight. At halftime, we're going to be announcing live into your homes the New South Wales State of Origin squad.
For the Newcastle Knights, Kurt Gidley is the fullback and the skipper. James McManus, Junior Sauer, Keith Lalia and Aku Uwate, the three-quarter line. Ben Rogers and Jared Mullen, the halves. The pack: Tafua, De Goyes, Houston, Simpson, Taya and Hilda, Nadira, Caruana, Feoso and Wicks. Brian Smith is the coach. I caught up with Brian and the Cowboys coach Neil Henry a short time ago. Brian, 10 weeks in, are you happy with the balance of the footy side?
Yeah, I think we've shown this year that we've got a pretty good squad, and we're mixing up some pretty good defence, which will get a test tonight, I'm sure, against the great attacking team. And we've played some good attacking footy as well. So, you know, we couldn't have asked for too much more than where we're at the moment.
As a coach, what's been the real positive? Individual form or cohesion?
Yeah, probably the latter. Andy, I think the way that our guys have just got a great feel for each other, they're enjoying each other's company, they're even getting on pretty well with the coach. You know, all the coaches are, you know, we're all working well together, and if... we're only halfway. We know we've got a long way to go this season, but it is promising for us.
Stopping Jonathan Thurston, how much of the game plan revolves around their number seven?
Oh, yeah, a considerable amount. He's probably the best halfback in the game at present, certainly one of the best halfbacks of all time. I think really he does so many things that reminds me of Andrew Johns, and you know, that I tried plenty of times as a coach to get my team to be able to stop him, but J2's just as tough to stop, I think.
Wish you all the best in the rain.
Thanks.
21st game head-to-head, the Newcastle Knights hold the advantage. They also hold a 5-4 advantage here at Townsville's Dairy Farmers Stadium. Kick-off at 7 o'clock. Two good footy sides head-to-head tonight.
Coming up, more from Townsville as Wazza, Loz and Brandy give us their spin on tonight's game. There's a brain explosion or two, plus some pure genius in our set of six this week. And we'll see whether the Knights can make it three straight wins against the Cowboys. All of that when we return on the Bundy pre-game show. Time to cross now to Townsville for kickoff in tonight's blockbuster between the Cowboys and the Knights. And was it two of the form teams of the competition? It's easy to say, pretty much at full strength, and we're set for a cracking match.
Yes, that we are, Ryan. A very big one here tonight. The Knights have won 6 of 7, of course. The Cowboys have been in good form as well. They've won 4 from 5. Can the Knights keep it going and perhaps take the premiership lead after 11 rounds, or can the Cowboys head them off at the pass?
4 out of 5, and the Cowboys' momentum is starting to turn heads. Thurston's brewing a cyclone in Townsville, and he's desperate to show this ain't no dry season in the tropics.
Thurston once again, surely gets a hat-trick.
But if you want lightning, there's a bolt at the back of the Knights pack who'll strike from anywhere.
Splits them to go down the field once again, and the Knights at their spectacular best.
Origin clouds are gathering tonight, and it's time for these men to prove who's got it in them.
Surrender here tonight. No white flags from either the Cowboys or the Knights. Thanks for joining us on Bundy Rum Monday Night Football.
Two very happy boys. 8 debutants, including the young bloke next to you. A very exciting time. A lot of pressure for New South Wales, but a very exciting time.
Exactly, mate. It's, I'll just say, you know, like you said, it's exciting and a good challenge for us. Looking forward to it.
Cowboys tonight, built on defence.
Mate, we've worked on it all off-season, and it's just good to see, you know, there's some things coming together for us.
Well done, buddy. Your whole teammates are waiting for you there. Also, congratulations to James McManus from Scotland via the Northern Territory. Tonight, you fulfil a dream.
Yeah, mate. Well, sort of as soon as I came to Australia, sitting down watching State of Origin with my old man, you know, it's a dream come true to be able to play for New South Wales.
A nervous couple of weeks when your name starts to get mentioned for the first time. I guess you're hopeful, but are you confident?
Yeah, well, I guess I'm used to being sort of a quiet achiever and not really getting much of a mention, but the last couple of weeks have been a bit different, but also exciting, and, you know, just looking forward to get down into camp.
Hey, debutants, it's a big task and a big ask, isn't it?
It is a big task. All the guys playing for Queensland are all great players, so it's, you know, they've got 3 on the trot, so it's going to be a big ask for us.
Let's hope your Newcastle captain and also your state captain, that knee isn't too bad. He's back in the dressing room already. Well done and congratulations.
Thanks, mate. No worries.
James McManus and Luke O'Donnell, enemies tonight, teammates in 9 days' time when they will take on the Queensland Maroons from New South Wales. But a big win by the North Queensland Cowboys. We'll talk about that and also the New South Wales team in our post-game show. Make sure you stay with us on Bundy Rum Football. More to come after this.
Phil Gould actually officiated a game as a touchy one at one time as a bit of fun. I reckon we can get you out there.
Mate, happy to give the referees as much help as possible. I'll be picking the referees for the State of Origin, the touchies, and to make sure we've got everything covered, Ryan,
4 video refs.
Mate, how are you going to fit all this in with everything you do with Friday night,
with the
Whizzer and everything
4
else?
Video referees will be round up. We'll see you after the break.
He's throwing
time
to the
for
break,
a quick
now.
Break.
Throw to the break, Whiz.
Okay, it's time for a quick break. We'll take you inside both these presses conference when we return. Stay tuned to Fox.
You're the wrong camera. Welcome back to the post-game show here on Bundy's Monday Night Footy. The Cowboys simply too good for the Knights this evening, winning 36 points to 10 in Townsville. Let's now hear from the visitors. Here's Brian Smith, Kurt Gidley and James McManus in the media conference.
Kurt, obvious question, the knee any better or any worse?
Oh, I don't know, it's a bit quick for that at the moment, but you need a bit more than this to stop me at the moment, I think. Didn't feel when it happened, but I think it was just a bit scary as well at the same time.
Same time as last year too, the cheekbone.
Yeah, I mean, that probably felt a lot worse than this. It was a, you know, thing straight away that I knew, but it was, you know, I heard this a few weeks ago, that was the same knee, so not a major thing, but just a bit scary, I guess.
You're in pain, you got ice on your knee, you've still got a smile on your face, I guess we should say congratulations too, first up.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think it's the proudest moment to date, so I'm really happy.
Cliche, but a dream.
Yeah, for sure. I think I said it through the week that, you know, it is a dream of a kid that when you grow up watching those big games, you know, it is cliche, you don't think it's going to happen to you, but a lot of hard work and it's paid off.
James, same applause. You're sitting there with a big smile on the face.
Yeah, definitely. Just remember coming to the country and you know, watching State of Origin with my old man and it's definitely a dream come true to be able to, you know, play for the team I supported as a kid.
Was it hard to focus on this match knowing that you had been picked and you were told pre-game?
No, always, ever since the name was sort of tossed up, always looking to play well for the Knights and, you know, unfortunately we didn't do too well tonight, but, you know, it's, you know, we'll be looking to do much better next time we get a run.
Does tonight's result take the sting out of it for either of you, a little bit, the edge off the happiness of the Origin selection?
Oh yeah, a bit of a rollercoaster ride for myself with the game and a bit of an injury and then to be picked in the team. It's a bit of a rollercoaster ride, but I'm more than happy about the being picked and being captain. Should be happy about that, I guess, and not the loss.
What about you, James?
Yeah, definitely the same. Just trying to keep it out of the back of the mind through the week, and then to be named is really a great honour. So it does take the edge off the loss.
Brian, you got a smile on your face. Obviously not at the performance, but obviously a proud coach.
I'm wrapped for both of them. I think. You know, Robbie Chew, our chairman in there, just said it to me about both of them. It restores your faith a bit in the game. One's a, you know, without being too rude, I hope, kids, told that at 15 or 16, like a lot of kids have been and gone on to become, successful players. It's a great story about Kurt. He's worked hard, and everyone in Newcastle and hopefully most people in footy now know, you know, just how hard he's worked to get where he is. It's a tremendous story, and Jimmy's is another one. You know, like for any kid who's maybe not living if you are living in a country town or somewhere out there in Footyville, wherever it is, you know, you're not out of it. You can definitely dream about playing for, you know, in the big arena like that. Jimmy's, you can't come from a more obscure background than that. Scottish boy in the Northern Territory, you know, that's just wonderful for our game. And, you know, Jimmy's work, he's a bit younger than Kurt, but he's worked just as hard. They're such dedicated blokes. Everyone in our club is really happy for him.
When you're the leader of this footy club, because of the names that have been before you, there's automatic pressure added to that. Kurt's surname, he's come out of all shadows, hasn't he?
Yeah, well, I think that's what makes everyone respect Kurt so much, is he's still himself, you know. He's been affected by his brother, who's a fantastic footballer, and living in the shadow, all that sort of stuff just doesn't take the edge off his personality. And he talks how he's learned about stuff from Andrew and Danny Bedaris, and you know, he just continues to be himself anyway. So again, it's a great, I think there's a great story in all that for all of us to enjoy.
Were you doing the right thing by the Blues with 8 minutes to go, getting ice on that knee early?
Well, I tried to get him to come off early, but that's typical of Gidsy. Was he didn't want to be, you know, we were in for on the back end of a great performance from the Cowboys tonight. We shouldn't be glossing over that. They were too good for us tonight, but he didn't want to desert his, you know, his teammates, as a captain probably should. He just kept wanting to bat out there, so eventually we sort of put a bit more pressure on him and got him off. But you know, I just hasten to add there, Kurt's, he had an infection in his knee prior to the game, but he's had a bit of a wobble, which was why he reacted, I think, down there under the goalpost when his knee was wrenched. So, but the doctors in there assuring us both that he's got, it looks like a grade one sort of medial type thing. So,
Gids, you're not known as a puncher on the field. You reacted. Was the first thing that went through your mind, oh God, I hope I'm not reported for this?
Well, the first thing that went through my mind was, you know, how bad is it? You know, I did react just on fear, I think, because I was worried about how, you know, just it's not something normal that happens to you, and the position I was in, and yeah, I don't normally react like that, and I'll probably regret reacting like that, but as I said, just reacted in fear, I guess.
Greg, you could be sick of the sight of Jonathan Thurston in 12 days, two straight games against him, and he is in rare form.
Yeah, I mean, he's been playing well. Everyone knows what sort of plays he has in his game, and they're still hard to stop. So, no, we're looking forward to the next challenge.
Brian, what about the game? Obviously, the worst performance by the team from your perspective this season. Is it something?
I don't know whether it was
tonight.
I thought the opposition were probably the best that we've played this year. You know, we couldn't get a call to go our way. I think we were close on three or four other occasions. Score could have been a bit closer than it was. We were definitely outplayed. Their defence was outstanding, I thought, tonight. And then, you know, on the back of that, we all knew what attacking skills they had. Their performance was comprehensive, and ours was patchy, I thought.
Well, there you go. I reckon that has to be the happiest coach we've ever seen in a losing media conference.
Well, you often see Brian Smith as the intense coach, the hard taskmaster. But tonight, I think we saw the very human face of Brian Smith. A lot of pride in his players for making the... Well, Gidley for getting appointed as captain, and McManus as a debutant, and he was quite emotional. So it was good to see.
It needs to be said too, hats off to Newcastle, because Kurt Gidley, before him Danny Bedaris, before him Andrew Johns, the last three New South Wales captains all from Newcastle.
And it all comes from, I think, what Brian Smith, how he summed it up. Work hard, there's plenty of desire, and you've got to have a dream. And as a young kid coming through, you've got those three ingredients. You know, don't have to be the biggest. Not to be the strongest, but you've got that desire there, you have that dream and that, and you've got the ability to work hard with your teammates and bring the best out of you. And when you get to these big games, you get that opportunity, and that's what Brian was getting through to everyone. So it doesn't matter if you come from the city or way out in the bush somewhere, mate, there's opportunities out there for everyone. You've got to have that dream.
But it was also very interesting that he said it was the best side that the Knights have played this year, the Cowboys, so that's certainly a credit to them.